I have to apologize for the sound quality. That's my fault completely. I thought it was all the blame on Instagram Live where we did it on. So go follow her at I am Jacquelina at. But it was actually the headset I used, which was busted. It was already broken. I should not have used that. I didn't know that until I listened back to the audio. So it's a lot of, I did my best to salvage it. That's why it took a while. So in advance, I just want you to know that it's not her fault. It is my fault. And I'm taking the blame entirely because this episode is so chock full of information. As far as part one, you're going to find out, you know, she's a singer. She's a songwriter, artist. You know, she's married now. She's a proud wife. She is a nanny, formerly of 14 years, now officially a doula or a doula. I'm not doing it on purpose, Jacquelina. I'm sorry. I apologize. It's just the word still confuses me a little bit because of how much is involved with it. Also, it's still the first time, you know, since I interviewed you, since I've even said it, you know, back to hear myself like that too. But a doula, just picture it like it's someone that coaches you into having your baby in your arms safe and sound. That's her job. She's not delivering the baby. She's just kind of guiding you through the whole process to make sure it's smooth sailing, pretty much. Literally, no pun intended, with the baby coming out of the mother once delivered and such. But yeah, check her out. I am Jacquelina, excuse me, on all the socials, everywhere you can find her. She's got great stuff coming too, as you'll see in this episode, part one, and then part two next week, which will follow. And again, I'll probably have to apologize for the sound as well, too. I did my best to salvage it. I'm a dummy. I'm an idiot. I should have checked beforehand to make sure the gear was working. It wasn't. But I did not want to sacrifice this episode or part two either, just for the sake of how much information you get out of her and how much she does in an everyday compared to one I'm able to probably do, hopefully, in a year in comparison. That means I suck. She's great. That's why I had her on as a guest. Check her out again at I am Jacquelina, everywhere you can find her. And, you know, if you feel like throwing me a bone, you know, getting back to charity, you know, because I'm bald, you know, and everything, angry and dumb. At Who This Is One, everywhere, socials, YouTube, Twitch, all that good stuff. And yeah, stay tuned. Here's part one.
But yeah, I'm a birth doula.
You're a birth doula, yes. That is the part that really, not to say that anything else, part of your credentials didn't, like, stand out to me already, but that was kind of like the icing on the cake as far as, like, I got to talk to her because I'm like, I never heard that term before, to be honest. I don't think I'm anywhere near having children heavily involved in my life, so it'll be a first time for me learning firsthand from a doula expert like yourself. So you are a wife. You're a pop artist yourself. As you mentioned, you're a doula. You're a nanny. You're the founder of another page you run, Mental Health Songwriter Nights.
Yeah.
In Nashville. And yeah. Obviously with that, a mental health advocate. And by the way, oh yeah, because you feel like it, a model on top of that too. So let's not forget that part either. Because we do have to talk about everything I listed. You got to talk about your music as well. Really like that new single you got out now, Pretend.
Thank
that song
you.
In the video.
Thank you so much.
And of course, how about beginning your name right? Is Jacquelina?
Fairly close. Jacquelina.
Jacqueline.
Perfect. That's perfect. That's it.
Jacqueline.
Yeah.
So, in that case, where does that originate from, that name?
My name? So, it is the Albanian version of the French name Jacqueline, which I, like, for the longest time, I was like, oh, my name means, like, knowledgeable and wisdom, because when I was younger, my mom, like, I don't know who told her that, but, like, she got somebody, like, to print it out on this, like, piece of paper, and I would be like, look, my name says Jacquelina, and it means wisdom, because of this piece of paper that my mom had it all printed out on. But whenever I would, like, do research on it, nothing really showed up. So then I did even deeper research, and I'm like, okay, well, I know Jacquelina is the Albanian version of Jacqueline, so what is the root name of Jacqueline? And then I discovered that that was Jacob. And I was like, oh, that's kind of cool. And Jacob's from the Bible. And, like, I was just like, so basically, my name is the feminine Albanian version of Jacob.
Okay.
So I was like, okay. Cool.
Wow, that is much more than expected just from, I would have never guessed, obviously, because of the Z and the H starting off with. So that would have thrown me off completely.
Yeah. So that's where the, like, Albanian spelling kind of kicks in. So my mom's side of the family is Albanian. So, yeah, my name's Albanian.
Nice. Well, good to know. I mean, I guess you could loosely associate yourself, you got that in common with the Kardashians, whenever they announced their Albanian roots, I guess, right?
I don't know. I actually don't know a whole lot about the Kardashians, to be honest with you. Albanian. I have a friend that's like really obsessed with them, but I don't really know a whole lot. But that's really cool if they're Albanian. I know Dua Lipa's Albanian, so that's cool.
You got a big trump card right there with Dua Lipa. Yeah, and she's proud of it too. She'll flex that whenever she has to.
I'm proud of it. I'm like, ooh, we're both Albanian. So that's really cool. Because you know, I just feel like as far as like global superstars and all of that, you don't hear a lot of like Albanian ones. So like the fact that Dua Lipa's like up there and a lot of people know her and respect her, I'm like, she's Albanian. That's really cool.
That is cool. I mean, she might be the first one, I guess, musically speaking, right? That's Albanian representing like that on a larger scale.
On that level? I think. I mean, I would probably have to do a little more research to 100% confirm, but my guess is yes. Guess.
I don't think it gets much higher than her anyway at this point now, so good for Dua Lipa.
Yeah.
And I guess maybe it's meant to be, you know, she's Albanian, Dua Lipa. I'm not sure if that's her real name or just stage name, but you're a Dua, so, you know, Dua Lipa, maybe that can balance itself out to work in your favor with your career, too. Or yeah. She'll be like, she'll stumble upon, you know, what your title is, and they'd be like, hey, that kind of sounds like me, Dua Lipa. Maybe I should work with it. But, oh, you're Albanian, I'm Albanian. Hey, it works out. Let's make some music already.
Maybe. Who? If the stars align, we'll see.
That would be awesome.
Yeah. It would be cool to meet her. I like her music a lot. And then another one just dawned on me, Bebe Rexha. She's another one that's also Albanian.
You know, we'll get to everything pretty much you do, because you got a lot to put into detail and perspective as far as it seems like a Rolodex, your resume, pretty much everything you do and you're currently active in. But why not start off with the one that kind of stood out to me, which is you're a, now am I saying this correctly, doula?
A doula.
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 Birth doula.
Okay. A birth doula.
Yeah, so that's actually the newest addition to what I do. So I've been a professional nanny for a while, and I've been nannying for a total of 14 years this year. And I really fell in love with the childcare industry for multiple reasons. One of the reasons, obviously, is because of the kids. They're really awesome. I love kids. And I really enjoyed watching them grow and helping them be a part of, or being a part of, like, helping them through their milestones and their developments and, like, just all the things that kids go through as they're growing up. I just think it's the coolest thing to experience and to watch. But I also really love, like, just the family aspect of it, too. Like, through being a nanny, I've gotten close with so many families, and specifically the moms, of course. Like, I feel like I become really good friends with all the moms that I've worked for. So in that experience, I've learned a lot about these moms' birth stories. I've learned about, like, a lot of traumatic experiences that these moms have had. So there's another mom that I became friends with, and she was telling me how she was, like, really allergic to a specific material, and she had put it on the birth plan that she did not want this material to be near her, and the nurses neglected the birth plan and still applied that material on her, and her husband ended up speaking up and saying, like, hey, like, my wife is allergic to this, and she had a severe allergic reaction, and she was like, if I had had, like, a doula there, like, the doula would have been the middle person to be like, hey, like, my job isn't to speak up for the person, it's to speak up to, like, for the person to be aware that that's an opportunity for them to say, wait a minute, do I need that, so that they can advocate for themselves, because, like, a lot of people think, like, doulas advocate for the mom, and I think, like, sometimes it can come across that way, but I see it more as I'm helping the mom advocate for themselves, because I feel like I did a good job if the mom is looking back and, like, feeling empowered by her birth experience, feeling like she was not knowledgeable of all of her options. She said, like, yes, because she really meant it. She was asked these questions and like she was just aware of the whole process, versus like a lot of times in the delivery room, like doctors are just doing stuff and they're not yeah. telling you why. So like my job is to just be like, hold on, like, and then I like look at, like, when something comes up that I know, like, the mom might not, we could, because we talk about it before we go into delivery, that I know, like, the mom has told me, like, oh, I don't think I want to do that. Like, I don't think I want an episiotomy. I don't think I want any med drugs or whatever. And like the doctor's like, I'm going to do this. It's like, hold on one second. How do you feel about this? Are you comfortable with that? And then the mom gets to say, like, do I need this? Like, you know, and sometimes situations too. Like I always, I'm more of like, I take a holistic approach as a doula. So I'm not like totally against like medicinal interventions. I actually value them and I see them as a safety net. And I also think that there's no shame in wanting to use them if that's what you feel like is going to give you the best birth experience for you. I just don't think that it's healthy to pressure anyone to do it if they don't feel like it's necessary or don't need it or don't want it or any of those things. So sometimes, like in my recent birth, the mom like wanted to go all natural, and she did up until like she pushed the baby out, and then like there were several medical interventions that like had to happen, because the way I describe it is it's a safety net. So I know we don't always want these things to happen, but sometimes like it's like a matter of like life or death, and you have like a couple seconds to decide. It's like you need it. And that's where like I think also having a birth doula is important, because like when things don't go the way that you thought they would or envisioned they would, you have that extra support there, and your partner has that extra support there, because it's a lot on your partner as well. Trauma is traced back to as early as being in the womb. So if like I can be a part of a process that helps like healthier births and healthier babies and start that from the get-go and helps women have like more empowered, healthier births and like feel like they've had a more successful birth than maybe some of their past births, like that's what I want to keep doing. And a lot of these women that I've been connecting with since I started doing this have been so inspiring to me. Just, it's really the coolest job. Like, it's so inspiring to see a woman do something that she's like, I don't know how I'm gonna push this baby out, and then she does. It's like the coolest thing ever. Like, women really are like superheroes. We are a really major support role. Like, that's the biggest thing that we do. Like, I'm not a doctor, I'm not the one catching the baby, pulling the baby out, I'm not a nurse, but I am a lot, like, a lot of people do compare us to being like pregnancy and birth coaches, because we do like a lot of breathing exercises and all of that, a lot of compassion, a lot of empathy. And then I offer informative support, which is really important, because that's where like research comes in, me being resourceful, me reaching out to like my network and trying to find answers for my clients, and also trying to connect them with people and like resources that they need and value for their birth plan. You just have that additional help, which is great, because there's so much that goes, like, you don't even realize that's important that you need when you're going to have a baby. And then physical support. So, like, that's probably the one that, like, during the actual delivery, like, when the baby's coming, like, that's the one that can feel the most, like, taxing, because, like, you're on the whole time, like, between, like, helping mom move, giving her massages. Like, I use a lot of like essential oils if the mom is like open to that, wants that. You know, the breathing exercises, I would also consider that a form of physical support, because you're helping them like do something physical that's meant to like help relax and regulate their bodies. So there's a lot of physical support that goes into it. And like, I learned all of these different awesome like massages and different birth positions that like really help either ease pain or help like push baby out a little bit more regularly, which is really interesting, because not every mom is going to feel comfortable in the same position. Like, some moms like will literally push their baby out when they're squatting, and then other moms like can totally do it laying on their back, and then other ones like want to do it while they're leaning like over something like a chair or the bed. Like, it's really interesting. Like, it's different for everybody. And I think like one of the things that I'm learning since I started this career is really like helping moms listen to their body and be attuned with their bodies and their baby. Because like you can read all the books you want, you can watch all the movies you want, all the documentaries, all the things. Like you have to be like as in tune as you can be with your own body, because it's not going to be 100% the same as anyone else's experience. There might be aspects of it. And at the end of the day, I still think it's really good to like read the books and watch the documentaries and all of that, because there's a lot of valuable information that you'll implement in some way. I just wouldn't like take it as like 100% like the way that they described it, that's how it's going to be for me. I would more so like everything you learn, take it in pieces and figure out where those pieces belong for your story. So yeah.
Honest question. I think you said in my notes that you had your first delivery in February?
February, yeah.
Nice.
Yeah.
Have you had any since then, or was it just so far?
I have. I'm planning on having a few more this year. Okay. I am currently very focused on my music right now. So this spring has been booked out for music videos, shows. I have a really big mental health songwriters night coming out in May. There was something you had brought up where you were like wondering how I like kind of balance all of this like in our DMs.
Yeah.
And a lot of that, it really like the way I'm kind of going into this is like seeing it as like different seasons are for different avenues of my work. So like certain seasons will be more doula focused, other seasons are going to be more like music focused, and then there's different aspects of the music, because there's like seasons for like performing for me, and then there's seasons where it's more of like me writing my music and putting it out and doing like co-writes and writing songs for other artists and things like that. Because if you're trying to do all of that at once, nothing, it's gonna be a circus.
I can imagine.
So yeah. I have a planner. I really, during COVID, I got myself incredibly organized. I also got married, and like planned my whole wedding and all of that, which like that really like helped me be a lot better at organizing as well, because I didn't have a whole lot of help through that. So like having to plan a wedding is no joke. But since then, I've kind of like just stayed that way, like planner every year. And I like my whole calendar. It's like I have all these different like blocks for like what I'm doing at what time, because I just think if you're going to move forward in any of your goals, you have to really like plan it out instead of winging it. Like I used to wing a lot of things, and now I'm like really trying to get better and better every year about like how I do, like the process of how I do everything. And I'm learning that it's allowed me to grow and be a lot more successful with my goals. For instance, like with my last birth, I was also like, we worked as a team. It wasn't like I took over the partner's role. I will say a huge benefit of having a doula is like for moms out there who don't have a partner, who don't have anybody that can be there, like a doula is someone who would be able to be there. And that's like, you know, not just anybody that would be there. That's somebody who like has studied this field and they know a lot about births, and they trained to be a doula and like a support role in the birth room. The birth partners need a lot of support too. And they're often not trained and they don't know how to respond to certain things. And on top of that, like they're being affected. Like if they see their wife in pain and like they're like, you know, being affected by that, they don't know what to do. It's like nice to have somebody there to also offer them emotional support, you know. And like if they've been up all night massaging their wife, massaging her feet, helping her move, doing birthing positions, they'd like to have an hour of like a nap or something. Like, okay, cool, like let me tap in and I'll be the one doing it. And like it's just having another like support role there. But instead of it just kind of being like a friend or another family member, it's someone who like knows about this industry, knows about this field, and is trained to be a support role for this specific experience. I mean, I'm married and my husband is incredibly supportive and like so sweet and very like, I just know he's going to be so involved when my time comes. I'm still going to want a doula.
Okay, so a doula for a doula. Yeah, that makes sense. I mean,
still going to want a doula because I really think that I think that like every birth should have a doula. Because the nurses are very focused on the medical aspect of things and very focused on the baby. And making sure baby is healthy, baby is okay. And then your doctor, you know, saying that your doctor that you have been seeing, your OB that you've been seeing since you got pregnant, like, if they can make it, right? Like, hopefully they can, because babies come when they want to come.
Yeah.
Which a lot of times they do. Like, my last birth, like, her OB was able to be there, and she was so grateful for that. But they're literally there for the delivery. So it's like, you know, and then after, like, you have different nurses rolling around, like, not rolling around, but, like, rolling through the room, and, like, you don't have the same nurse the entire time. So just having, like, this one person there that's a supportive role, that's been a part of the entire process, that knows everything that's been going on and can even help explain it to, like, the new nurses coming into the room. Like, I worked a lot as a team with the other nurses in the birth room, and that felt really cool. Like, oh, we need socks. Okay, I'm going to go run out and grab some socks from the people at the front table, and, like, you go get blankets for her. And, like, you know, it just felt so good. And then, yeah, like, I just think it's like it's a role in a team-based environment, and mine is primarily focusing on the mother. So, like, where everyone else is really, like, I mean, it's not like they don't care about the mom, but they're very focused on the baby and, like, the medical aspects of that and making sure that the baby comes out alive. I'm very focused on the mom and her needs.
Makes total sense. Yeah.
So there's this, like, you know, and then, like, dad's there just like, everybody's okay, right? So, yeah, I just think it's this, like, really valuable part of a team environment.
Nice. I mean, from the sound of it, yeah, you are essential to the mom, first and foremost. But question now would be, I guess, you said you were a professional nanny for 14 years.
Mm-hmm.
So how do you make the transition from a nanny into a doula?
I was just ready. Like, it just felt natural for me. Like, I'm like, I could keep nannying for my whole life if I wanted to, but I felt like spiritually for myself, so I'm a Christian and I'm really spiritual about a lot of my choices in my life. And spiritually, I just continued to learn more and more about doulas in a way that wasn't like I was going after it. It kind of kept coming to me, if that makes sense, like a calling in a way. And, like, I'm really skeptical about that stuff at first, but when it comes up in different ways, in so many ways, and then I start to do research about it, and, like, it all really resonates with my soul. I'm like, wow, this feels really, like, right. And so I prayed about it for a year. I prayed about it. I did research. I had conversations with other people who had been doing it, because I didn't even know what a doula was. Before 2020, I didn't know what it was. And I was just like, whoa. And then, okay, this is gonna sound really funny, but it's so, for me, like, this ended up being the cherry on top. I think it was Chris Stapleton was, like, performing, and his wife was supposed to be performing with him at this show. And last minute, she couldn't make it because she's a doula. I was like, oh my gosh, that's so cool. A songwriter and a doula. And I was like, that feels like me. Like, that's me. And so I just, again, like, that was just, like, another spiritual confirmation for me that was just, like, I could do this if I want to do this. So I did a lot more research on it and researched the different doula programs that were available, and I came across Harbor Birth Institute. They're in Franklin, Tennessee. They're amazing. And I was professionally trained by them after having several conversations with them about it, and, like, seeing, like, just, like, the first time I called them, I was like, so I've been praying about this for a long time, researching it, all this stuff, and I feel like, you know, and I've been a nanny for a long time, and I just feel myself needing to step forward in this, like, caregiving industry in a way that's going to challenge me. I need to be challenged. So I talked to them for a really long time, and I was just like, if you think that this is a good fit for me, then, you know, I'm going to sign up and do this. And they thought that it was a perfect fit for me. So, and it is, like, I love it. Oh my gosh. After my first birth, it was like the biggest adrenaline rush since I like jumped off a plane and went skydiving. Like, it was incredible. Like, amazing, amazing, amazing. Like, I didn't even need coffee to stay awake. Like, it was that good. I needed coffee after I was done, I will say.
Oh,
I'm
sure you did. Because
yeah. I got out of the hospital, like, middle of the day, and I was just so, I was tired and still had other things I had to do. But during the process, did not need coffee.
How intensive is the training compared to, like, anything else that would be, like, a doula, I mean, specifically?
Yeah. So I'm still technically in the certification process. You need to have several births under your belt to be fully certified. You need to be fully trained before you can. Well, you don't actually need to be. There's people doing doula work that haven't been trained, but I would want to be trained because it's a lot. The training process was like a whole weekend. We were in this cute little cabin in Franklin, like my training class, and we all like went through the entire doula handbook together and did all these different birth positions that we practiced with each other. Like, it's like it was a very intense long weekend where we got all of our training done. And then since then, it's been a lot of documentaries that I have to watch, a lot of books that I've had to read. There's tests that I have to take, and then there's the actual like doula work that I have to do as well. But on my own outside of that, because I don't know that I would consider myself a perfectionist, but I really care about doing things well. So I have connected with a lot of other people who have been in this field for way longer than I have, and just been getting coffee with different doulas and picking their brains and learning from them. I had to go and get certified to be able to go into the operation room in case one of my clients needed or wanted a C-section for one of the hospitals out here. Like, there's all these different things that you don't know, like, you have to do unless you're doing it. So that's another thing that I learned that I was like, oh, that's really cool. Like, there's a lot of women that I know that are incredible doulas that have never had their own kids.
Late last year, I think, the EP, right?
The EP release, yeah.
And that's 17 Reasons Why 3?
Yes, yeah.
Okay, and I was only able to check out that one, at least on Spotify. I didn't check anywhere else to see if one or two were up anywhere.
Okay.
But
they are.
Why 3 in that case? 17 Reasons Why the third time around. So.
Yeah, so 17 Reasons Why is a series of EPs that I started releasing in the beginning of 2018. So there's going to be a total of 4 EPs, and altogether it's going to be about 17 songs. And every single song on this project is flipping the script of the series 13 Reasons Why. Have you ever seen that on Netflix? I think it was on Netflix, I don't know if it still is.
Sounds familiar, but
essentially the premise is like 13 reasons why this person ended up taking their life. So this is like another take on my like mental health advocacy. So I wanted to write and like create this entire project to flip the script and say like, these are reasons why you matter, you belong, and you are where you're supposed to be, that your life does matter. And I chose the number 17 because, again, I'm a spiritual person. Mm-hmm. So the number 17 to me means that you are where you're supposed to be. So instead of releasing like an entire album all at once, I felt like it was wiser of me to take all of my creative work and spread it out, and just put a little more behind each release. And I think that optimizes like the views, the fan base, like just all of that versus like, you know, especially nowadays, like people's like attention span is like this. You know, when you release something, like you don't want to put like 20 songs out. I don't think you want to put 20 songs out at once, because I don't think all those songs are going to be listened to the way that they probably deserve to be listened to. So I did it in the very, that was like kind of my like business take on like how I did it. I like to integrate everything that I'm learning, and 17, like I'll be releasing the fourth EP. I initially wanted to release it at the end of this year, but it'll probably be next year because I have a huge single that I'm releasing, another one after Pretend this year that involved like a major like 4-day music video shoot, and there's just a lot more going into the promotion and behind the scenes of all of that than I had thought. And it's great, like it's really great, but now I'm having to move around some other things that I had planned, and that includes the fourth EP release. So that's either going to be coming out at the end of this year or at some point next year, most likely some point next year. But yeah, so 17 Reasons Why is dedicated towards my mental health awareness, like that every single song on there is either like a personal story or some sort of message that I think is important in alignment with mental health. I even have songs on there that there's one song called Man with a Gun, which is about my personal experience with a shooting that I experienced in 2014 that was like super traumatizing, and it took me until 2017 to write about it. Like there's really powerful songs on this project, and that one's in the first EP. But yeah, I released the third EP in December.
But then you end off with Let's Go to the Park, which was kind of just out of left field for me once I was already getting through the first three, because it's like kind of happy, cheery, boppy.
Yeah.
And I thought, since you're a doula too, you know, it seems like you got the chops, per se, to maybe do like kids songs. So once you're like the total package, you're there for the mom before they're born, the child is born, you got the kids songs ready for them to, you know, put on replay. Like you could be their what's the one the kids love right now so much, like Coco Melon or all the other kid things like that.
Yes, all the shows, although a lot of moms are not a fan of Coco Melon.
I thought the one that moms only like was Peppa Pig.
But definitely Coco Melon. Coco Melon's on a lot of moms' radar of don't show my kids. So
I would think that, because the meme is mostly like Coco Melon's like kind of traumatizing because they have it on an endless loop all day, the kids. They just won't stop watching it.
That's TV like in general.
Well, I mean, kids with a tablet now, so I'm sure, you know, the moms will tell you in the future, like, that's like, there's no way of getting them off for that. They're like super glued to it.
Well, we have to work hard then, like as their caretakers, to make sure we're intentional about making sure that like they learn how to be present and not glued to a device all the time.
Did you have any of that before you transitioned to a doula while you were still a nanny? Like,
oh yeah, which I mean, if you do some, like if you are creative and you like have a fun day planned out for the kids, like you just got to keep them busy. They get bored. I got bored too when I was a kid. Like I think it's like just important to make sure that you're doing things that keep them engaged. Otherwise, like it is going to be challenging to get them off the TV. But yeah.
When you say you like kids, do you mean like you actually like kids enough to make it your career? As in doing both, or I like kids as long as they're not my own, and then you go home, you know.
Oh, I definitely want to have kids.
You do?
Okay. Yeah, I mean, maybe just one, probably not more than two, but I definitely want to have kids. My husband and I talk about it all the time.
Ideally, would it be just one, or how many do you have in mind?
Ideally, you know, I don't know. It's hard. It's funny because when I was just telling a friend of mine this, when I was younger, I used to think I would be like married by 21 with three kids by the time I turned 25, and like I didn't get married until I was 28, going on 29, I think, if I remember correctly. Wait, yes. Yes. Math. And then like, you know, like, and we want to have kids, but we'd like to like be a little more prepared. I don't think we'll be fully ready whenever that time comes, but we'd like to be a little more prepared in certain areas of our lives. before we bring a kid into the world. So,
and I mean, going back to the music too, the latest single is Pretend that you released back in February with the video and the single. I was watching the video and it was really kind of like, I had to watch it again twice along with the song just to make sure I got it, and hopefully I did. So is Pretend kind of like you referring to how we pretend in our daily lives to be okay because of the three scenarios? You got the you're amongst a group of people, you're then in the room with the guy, and then you end with the I'm assuming the divorced parents, kind of, and you're in the middle, kind of like being the gel that kind of holds them together, hoping that all in all, just pretend I'm okay and it'll be okay.
So that is really, you are on the right path. It's about the ways that we pretend to be someone, like somebody that usually we're not, to fit in with these different groups. It's the ways that we seek acceptance that are not authentic. And one of those ways is, I really believe that a lot of people will pretend to be okay when they're really not okay. Part of the message of this is like to take like your mental health seriously and to look at the patterns, because when you follow that pattern, whether it's in the realm of your friendships or like romantic life, family, there's something linear there, and you can really follow. And again, this is all because of all the therapy and like work that I've done. This is not something I just came up with by myself. This is truly from all of the healing and support that I have chosen to integrate into my well-being and life. But when you follow that, like you can get to a lot of the core issues that like made you believe like you needed to seek this false sense of acceptance. And I just think that when you get there and you work on it and you work on healing that, like, I don't think healing is linear. I think like it's this like messy situation, but it is very possible, and you just have to stay the path. And as you heal different things, I always feel like it's like I feel it in my body. They say like we carry trauma in our body, so when I heal certain parts of my trauma, I can truly feel it like leave my body.
Do you think maybe still there's more we got to do as far as like taking it seriously?
Oh my god,
or are we doing way more? Definitely,
yeah.
I'd say so still.
Well, and it's not all their fault either. So, I mean, I don't think that the government and society and the people who have a lot of money are exactly helping, because mental health care is so not as accessible as it should be. It's just really challenging, because it's like, you know, I'm not trying to point a finger here, but like we need to make like mental health care accessible. Like I think that if it was destigmatized and it was accessible, and people actually respected it, I just feel like we would really like get along better. I'm not saying world peace over here, but I do think like people would get along better. I do think that we would resolve a lot of issues healthier, you know, and just people would feel more satisfied with their lives. But that's going to take like the whole village.
Oh yeah. Everybody getting involved.
Yes.
Absolutely.
Yeah. So when like, you know, I'm here doing my part, I can't force anybody else to do it. I can't force anyone to do anything. Like I believe in free will. So I'm not trying to like, you know, make anybody do anything. It's one thing to say like that mental health needs to be destigmatized and more accessible. It's another thing to actually be doing it. So I think it all starts with a conversation, like anything, just talking to people and being willing to like listen, and also like encourage people that like it's healthy to care about how you feel.
Absolutely. It's vital, absolutely. Because just like you care for whoever you work with as a doula, it all starts with, you know, looking on the inside, working on the outer too.
Yeah.
It all reflects.
Yeah. Yeah. It really does.
So being a person of faith though, Have you been a lifelong Christian, or did you become one along the way, or?
I have not been a lifelong Christian. I was agnostic most of my life. My mom's side of the family is Muslim, and my dad's side is Catholic primarily. And I wasn't really, I wouldn't say I was raised religious, but I was taught that there is a God. I just didn't really know a lot about him. And I didn't come to know Jesus until I was 23. And I would say, like, just on a personal spiritual note, like, that he has been pursuing me my whole life. It just took, like, all these different things to line up for me to see that, and to believe it. I've been a Christian now for going on 8 years, 7 or 8 years. Yeah, I'm turning 31, 8 years.
Now, before you became a Christian, were you already going through therapy? Were you dealing with your mental health?
I had been in and out of therapy. I wouldn't say I was consistent with it. I wasn't consistent with my health. I wasn't really consistent with a lot, to be honest with you. I was just trying to figure my life out. Going through the third divorce in my family with, like, my parents. Like, my dad's been divorced twice. My mom going through, like, it's just a lot of different stuff. And then, like, I graduated from college and trying to figure out what I was going to do with this degree that costs a lot of money. and, like, you know, being an adult out of college looks very different from being an adult in college. So it's just like a lot, all these different stressors. And I had a few people around me that continued to invite me to church, and I went to church, and it wasn't like all of my stress and like went away and all of my problems were answered. It wasn't like that. It was more so like I realized I wasn't alone, and I had never been alone, and like that's the game changer for me.
Along the path, as far as you developing your relationship as a Christian and such, I've heard about it before. I've seen it in my own family before, like people that align themselves with a certain faith. If the topic of mental health or therapy comes up, it's like, oh, don't do that. Just pray on it instead. Have you encountered that at all? Or?
Yeah, I encounter it. That's called spiritual bypassing. So I do think prayer is really important. One of the reasons I think it's important is because that is us inviting God into our situations, because I think God is a gentleman, and I think that he cares. He will knock and he will be there, but he's not going to force himself upon you.
Right.
So I think prayer is like that medium to invite him into your situations. I also think that there's a lot of responsibility that an agency that we're given, but a lot of responsibility on us. Like, there's this saying where, like, somebody was, like, on top of, like, the roof of the house, and it flooded, and they kept praying for God to save them, and, like, God, and there was, like, three boats that passed the house, and, like, the guy was like, God, you never came to save me, and he's like, I sent you three boats. Like, why didn't you get on one of the boats? Like, it's very practical. Like, I think that, I do think that it's important to be pragmatic in life, and I do think that God gave us a brain for a reason to use it.
Oh, yeah. You would hope most do, but some surprisingly don't.
Yeah, I think it's important to incorporate the different gifts that God put a lot into for us to use. Like, he's like, I already gave you a brain, like, why don't you, like, use it? Like, just simple, like, just that's really there's a lot of times that I've had a lot of friends, like, pray about things that they did nothing for. I'm like, you keep praying about this, but what have you actually done to, like, make it happen? And they're like, I just feel like it's just, you know, it's just gonna happen for me, then, like, God's gonna make it obvious. I'm like, okay, let me know how that goes.
Right, praying for that phone call, praying for someone to knock on their door just because they're praying on it.
Yeah, and I mean, I do think miracles are possible. I think that we are miracles. I think that even using your brain and like, you know, just like the fact that like I can put my thumb up like this, like something that simple is a miracle. Like I don't think, you know, I feel like we minimize the miracle that is the breath that we breathe into our lungs. Like, and I feel like the more we lean into like how special our lives are, the more we realize how much God has already gifted us. And I think that, to be totally honest with you, prayer is mostly important for us to develop a deeper relationship with God versus this, like, let me rub the genie and, like, get him to answer my, you know, get him to do the things I want him to do. It's more so about, like, understanding who he is and just having that personal connection with him. And he helps you better understand the truth through that connection and who you are, too.
Yeah, because, I mean, it would be more like prayer without any footwork is pointless if you get nowhere, right?
Yep, that's scripture. Not that exact wording, but the message, yeah.
Yo, it's over, all right? It's over. Sure. Move the mic.
Thank you.
All right.